The UN's new emissions gap report is a thundering wake-up call to the world. Here's what you need to know. Current international plans to cut carbon emissions will not stop the planet's temperature rising above the 1.5 degrees Celsius target before the end of this century, according to the UN Emissions Gap Report, which says Earth will hit 2.7 degrees of warming unless humanity changes course drastically. The report says to keep global warming below 1.5 degrees this century, the world must halve annual greenhouse gas emissions in the next 8 years. The BBC explains that as things stand, around 50 countries have pledged to hit net zero, balancing the amount of greenhouse gas produced and the amount removed from the atmosphere by 2050. And this could reduce projected temperature rises by 0.5 degrees to 2.2 degrees by the end of 2100. However, this level of warming would still see dramatic and deadly impacts, and the report suggests two further problems with even those seemingly ambitious targets. First, the plans are quite vague, particularly in the world's 20 richest countries. And second, many of the plans postpone significant emissions cuts until after 2030, which makes it extremely difficult to imagine them delivering net zero just 20 years later. The report does contain recommendations about how emissions could be rapidly reduced, including explaining how methane emissions, the second largest source of warming, could be curbed at low or no cost. However, it is critical of COVID stimulus packages, finding that only around 20% of recovery investments will support renewables and the green economy. The new report adds sharp timelines to August's report from the UN's Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, which the UN Secretary General called a code red for humanity. That report outlined 5 different carbon reduction scenarios, ranging from a future with incredibly large and quick pollution cuts to one with further increases in carbon pollution. In 5 previous reports, the world was on track for the hottest scenario, with temperatures 3.3 to 5.7 degrees Celsius higher than pre-industrial levels by the end of the century. However, like this week's, the August report found the world was on track for a position between the next two scenarios down, with increases between 2.1 and 4.6 degrees due to moderate progress in reducing emissions. That, though, would still see far worse heat waves, droughts, and flood-inducing downpours raining down on us. The August report also identified how huge damage has already been done, with extremes such as heat waves, droughts, floods, and storms having become more prevalent, while tropical cyclones have become stronger and wetter, Arctic sea ice is dwindling in the summer, and permafrost is thawing. The world is locked in to 15 to 30 centimeters, or 6 to 12 inches, of sea level rise by 2050, according to report co-author Bob Kopp, who spoke to the Associated Press. Worse still, some of that damage is effectively irreversible, with diminished ice sheets, rising sea levels, and changes to oceans as they have lost oxygen and become more acidic, irreversible, for centuries to millennia. Throughout its 3,000-plus pages, the August report is clear that both the existing circumstances it describes and the future scenarios it sets out are caused by human activity, outlining how greenhouse gas emissions far outweigh natural contributions to global warming. Temperatures have warmed 1.1 degrees Celsius since the pre-industrial period, and the report explains that this is historically extraordinary, noting that around 125,000 years ago was the next most recent candidate for a period of higher temperature, which was caused by orbital variations. The August report ultimately concludes the same thing as this week's, though, which is that we can limit human-induced global warming by limiting cumulative carbon dioxide emissions and reaching at least net zero carbon dioxide emissions, along with making strong reductions in other greenhouse gas emissions. There are different ways we might do this, but proof that we are capable of dramatic international changes of direction on climate lie in our past. A recent study in the journal Nature found that if the world hadn't banned the chemicals that destroy the ozone layer with the 1987 Montreal Protocol, climate change would have significantly worsened global warming by the 2040s. The study found that a continued increase in chlorofluorocarbons, or CFCs, would have caused the ozone layer to collapse worldwide, which in turn would have led to a rise in ultraviolet radiation showering down on plants and animals. Without the agreement, the study states the tropics would have lost 60% of their ozone coverage by 2100, with mass exposure to unfiltered radiation damaging plant tissues, dramatically stunting their growth and limiting their ability to photosynthesize. According to Science Alert, a hole of that size would be even larger than the one that formed over Antarctica in the early 1980s, with the ultimate effect being that by 2100, damaged forests, soils, and other vegetation would not have been able to absorb a total of 580 billion tons of carbon dioxide. This would make the concentration of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere 40 to 50% higher. That increase alone would cause global temperatures to rise by 0.8 degrees Celsius or 1.4 degrees Fahrenheit. However, the CFCs themselves are also greenhouse gases, and they would have caused an additional 1.7 degrees Celsius or 3 degrees Fahrenheit of global warming by 2100. The total contribution to global warming increases that have been avoided through global commitment to the Montreal Protocol then is 2.5 degrees Celsius or 4.5 degrees Fahrenheit, according to the study. Which basically means that, yes, we are capable of changing the world for the better through deliberate intervention on a mass scale. As melting ice in Antarctica exposes land beneath it, the chain of processes set off may be capable of causing the sheet to collapse, according to a study in Nature Geoscience. Researchers looked at Earth 13 to 17 million years ago, when carbon dioxide in the atmosphere and global temperatures reached levels similar to those experienced by the end of this century, and said when ice sheets melt, the exposed land beneath is less reflective, so local temperatures become warmer. This can drastically alter weather patterns because Antarctic winds usually blow from the continent out to the sea, but if the continent warms up, that could be reversed, with winds blowing from the cooler sea to the warmer land. That would bring additional rainfall to the Antarctic, which in turn would cause more fresh water to run into the sea, according to a University of Exeter news release on Eureka Alert. Finally, because fresh water is less dense than salt water, it is less likely to sink and circulate, which means warmer water simply sits on top of the ocean, causing more warming. In line with that explanation, the study found that reductions in the area covered by ice sheets was far more important in creating further ice loss than reductions in ice volume. Because the more land is exposed, the more warming processes are encouraged. The study's lead author explained that, essentially, if more land is exposed in Antarctica, it becomes harder for a large ice sheet to reform. However, when this happened previously, it's possible that favorable orbital positions prevented a collapse. Earth's positioning relative to the sun caused the ice sheet to advance and retreat, and this altered weather patterns, and helped preserve, rather than melt, the ice in that instance.
For more news animations and explainers, hit the subscribe and bell button to join the Tomo News family. Thanks for watching.